Hi everyone, it's Angela from She Simply Impacts, and we are about to have a great panel discussion with Moana Robinson, our personal stylist on the platform, Sabina Armbruster, who is from She Momentum, and she is a business coach on our platform and an amazing facilitator, and the incredible Mary Wong from Optimal Leadership. And she does leadership sessions and she's a book coach. So come and check us out on She Simply Impacts. Today's topic that we're going to be talking about is overcoming overwhelm. So if you're a woman in business and you'll find this interesting because, you know, I'm sure that you've experienced overwhelm, even if you're not a woman in business, a professional woman with children and juggling many hats. So I'll hand it over to Sabina.
Thank you, Angela. This is actually a huge topic, and it's one that comes up for me and my clients all the time, and just in general discussion. I have no doubt at all that everyone on this panel has been through overwhelm in some form or other, probably not that long ago, in and out of overwhelm, and that's what we're going to talk about today. It's not something that just happens and you recognize and it disappears. You've got to deal with these things. So let's talk about that for a start. Angela, tell me first up, what does overwhelm look like to you? Like when it appears in your life, what does it look like?
Yes. So it looks like that I've got so too much going on that I lose sort of perspective on what are my priorities. Like everything's a priority. It's like everything's a priority right now. And I'm juggling a lot of different things and I have to get back to people and I've got to meet deadlines and I've got, you know, maybe things going on at home, a bit of adversity, whatever's going on, you know, and I'm sort of feeling so stretched.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Moana, what does it look like for you?
For me, when I feel overwhelmed, it's almost like when there is so much to do, you just end up doing nothing. I just, mm-hmm. For me, I've had times when I've just kind of frozen because it's too overwhelming to think about. And that's the feeling I get with overwhelm. It's just like a feeling of freezing and not even taking the smallest step to do the smallest thing until I can go through some processes to just work out, like Angela was saying, priority, what needs to be done right now, what is right in front of me.
Cool, thank you. Mary, how about you? What does overwhelm look like in your life?
It looks like clutter. There are so many things to be done all at once that, like Moana, thing gets done and then they build up and build up and build up, and that forms this sort of downward spiral where you just slide downwards and you end up with laundry all over the lounge room, you end up with a whole lot of missed deadlines, you end up with, it's not a pretty place to sit, and you get cranky, clutter and crankiness together, crankiness and frustration with yourself because you know better. All of those things, that's what it looks like for me.
Great. What it looks like for me is a really, really tight stomach, and it's horrible. And then I run around the house and I just run from one thing to the next. And if anyone's in my way, God help them. And then I think I'm going to work till midnight to get things done, but then I actually fall asleep at my desk. And I have done that a few times and I've gone, okay, enough's enough. Interesting how it all shows up differently for all of us. So my question then is, when you say, Moana, that nothing gets done, is that procrastination then?
Oh, yes.
Or is that a little bit different again?
It is. Actually, I was just talking to someone about this recently. I remember when I was studying for my beauty therapy, and it is a form of procrastination because I used to get this form of panic about studying as an adult student, and I would think, oh, the fridge needs cleaning. Well, I've got to go and scrub the shower out. And to do anything apart from what I am supposed to be doing. And yeah, I think it is, it probably is a form of procrastination because it's, to me, it just feels like a freezing, you know. And then I just think, oh, I'll just go and do this, I'll just go and do this, and anything apart from what actually I should be doing.
What's the longest time do you think you've ever been into in that space of avoiding what it is that you should be doing, procrastinating, freezing?
Not very long, really. It's probably not as long as I think it is because I've, you know, I've when you do coaching, you do self-coaching 101, and you know the things to do to get yourself out of that kind of situation. But to me, it feels like a long time. It feels like a waste of time. And the more you berate yourself, the more overwhelmed you put yourself into. But now I've learned what to do to get myself out of that overwhelmed situation.
Great. And we'll go on to strategies shortly. Angela, how about you? What is the longest period of time that you've been in procrastination or where you've just been avoiding doing things purely because of overwhelm? Because sometimes we don't recognize that we're in overwhelm for a while. You know, it kind of has this slow build-up, right?
Yeah, I think for me, I don't tend to do nothing. I think I always, I don't, I've heard other people say this as well, that you get so overwhelmed, like what Moana said, that you'd end up doing nothing. I think for me, I'm always doing something, you know. But what
Do
could
you think it's effective what you're doing?
Well, I don't, I mean, yeah, I guess so. I mean, as long as, like, because I suppose I can't, I jumping into strategies, you know, too soon, but, you know, sometimes, let's put it this way, sometimes I might be overwhelmed. I've got so much to do and I'm driving and I'm maybe on my way home, you know, and I'm like hurrying to get home. And there's this thought, just go, like, just swerve off at the shopping mall. You know, why don't I just swerve off at the shopping mall? But I don't do it. I think about doing it, but I don't. I just go home. I go home and I write out my list, you know, and just dump everything. I guess it just, I just fall back into strategy because I'm problem solving for myself. So.
And we'll talk about your strategy in a minute as well, because you have a daily routine that probably keeps you out of overwhelm more than a lot of people. But before we go into that, Mary, what about you? Does overwhelm build up over time? Is it called
Overwhelm.
overwhelm from one day to the next? How does overwhelm show up?
Overwhelm does build up over time. I have a tendency to take on too much and a tendency to underestimate how long something's going to take. I'll look at a job and think, yeah, I can do that. No problem. It's like 10 minutes a day. That's easy. But if your day's already full, 10 minutes a day adds. You know, it's like that bucket of stones with the pebbles between, with the sand between, and with the water in there. And it gets to a point where that bucket just doesn't even hold that extra 10 minutes and it overflows. And when you're in that space of accepting more, because, you know, we've lived through this period of time quite recently where people were told, don't say no to anything. Just say yes. Just say yes. You'll expand yourself by just saying yes. And that's actually a great strategy if you're somebody who says no to everything. It's not a great strategy if you're already someone who says yes to everything, because it kind of gives you permission to keep saying yes when you probably shouldn't. So I think the fact that I'm aware of that now and that I work towards decreasing that doesn't mean that I don't get overwhelmed. I still do on occasion because I'm human and I have these basic tendencies. But what it does do is it makes me pause now before I say yes and to think about it
So are
rather
you?
than.
I know you have a history of saying yes.
Yeah, I do.
And, you know, especially when people ask you specifically for something, you can't say no.
I
So
can say no.
when.
And no, see.
That's a good practice, Mary. Thank you. So when you find that you take on too much, How do you prioritize? Like, how do you say, okay, I'm going to do my power talk work or my leadership work? Or how do you then prioritize? Do you go, I'm just going to do the things I enjoy? Or what is it that you then do?
I always look at what's going to serve my values as the number one priority. Problem is, I don't say yes to things that don't serve my values. So, making sure that it serves my values is not enough. It's also about there's a degree of compartmentalization that goes on where I go, I need to put that aside side and finish this right now. Or I allocate certain amounts of times or certain times of the day to do things. What I find is the worst thing of all is when I try to do it all at once. And that really is, it's not good. You've been flicking between emails, doing one thing, doing another thing, off over here, having a conversation there. And that's when you really get into a tailspin. So you definitely need to go, all right, that's power talk. That's going in the power talk folder. You know, you see it arrive and you go, that's a power talk thing in the power talk folder. Don't even read it. Next,
Yep. Do you
in the email
find
thing, and then come back to it later when you've got that space.
that you prioritize based on people? You know, if you've got all these jobs and you know that that someone is waiting for something over here and you like that person, you know, you want to make sure that person is happy too, because that's, you know, a lot of the reason why we do things, right? But this over here is the thing that's actually bringing the income. So this is more important right now. What
Not
do
as
you
much as I
do?
used to. Not as much as I used to. I used to be, everything was based on, oh, that person wants that. I'll get done first, even though this isn't going to serve me so much. Now I'm more careful with that. I do fall back into that old pattern at times and go, oh, no, I want to keep Sabina happy. I'll get this done for her. But at the same time, I'm more inclined to say things like, hey, can I get back to you after 3? I've got to finish this thing that I'm on right now. I'm more inclined to say that rather than to jump in and just answer somebody or assist someone in that moment. Unless, of course, I know that there's a deadline that, because there's always a follow-on effect, right? So if you're in power talk as well, if you're saying to me, hey, Mary, this power talk thing that's got to be done by 5 tonight, I need this information so I can write this report that's got to go in, then that's when I'm going to answer you rather than saying, well, wait till 3 o'clock. Because that just puts more pressure on you. Now, Power Talk, for anyone who doesn't know, is a not-for-profit and everyone volunteers their time. So the less pressure we can put on people who are doing things, the better. But again, at the same time, at the moment, the person Sabina's writing a report to is usually me. So can give her a little bit of space as well and understand as much as I can. As much as I can give some leeway and things like that, I do, but you have to be, you just get yourself into a space of not functioning properly if you don't go, listen, I'll have to get back to you a little later, or even just pretend you didn't see them and get back 2 hours later, which I must say I don't really do. I don't tend to ignore messages.
Let's face it though, no one's going to die, are they?
No.
So,
And that's the thing. I mean, if it's an urgent, if it's my son having an anaphylaxis, it doesn't matter what's happening, I'm out of here. You know, like there are things that there is just nothing comes above. And when that happens, sorry guys, I'm out. Gone.
That's right.
You know, and that's how it works.
Angela, are you a people pleaser?
Not as much as I used to be. No, I don't think I am a people pleaser. I think I've gotten quite good boundaries. Well, the thing I have to come to terms with is the discomfort around pissing someone off. And so that is something I'm
Does
learning.
that happen often?
It's been happening lately a little bit in my personal life. And so I experience a lot of sitting with the discomfort, like.
Do you find that you do that more often when you are in a stressed space or overwhelmed and you're short with people?
Well, it's not so much even being short with people, it's just giving them the answer that they don't want to hear, or putting up a boundary, Like, I try not to be rude, but it's just a boundary that and then I feel incredibly selfish. And so it's like I have to sit with that. And then, of course, I beat myself up. And then once I finish beating myself up, I think, well, actually, okay, like I can only do what I can do. I just can only prioritize, I know myself, I know my limits. And so if I get to this limit threshold, then I guess I have to make that choice, don't I?
Isn't that interesting? So someone said to me recently that I can be quite short when I send messages or emails. I didn't know that. And it's made me stop and read and reread things before I send them because I too beat myself up when I give someone some information and there's a reaction, or I feel that I've offended them. It's interesting, isn't
Yes.
it? So, Angela, talking about boundaries, how important are boundaries to avoid overwhelm? Like, what do you do? How do you recognize when you need to put up a boundary?
It's usually I'm getting a lot better at it. I'm getting a lot better. So, like in the past, when I, was raising my daughter and married to my ex-husband, didn't used to put up the boundaries. And so then I would explode. I would get to the point where I'm exploding because it's just too, I just didn't communicate effectively. And so now what was your question?
When do you don't put up boundaries? How do you put up boundaries? How do boundaries affect or avoid you going into overwhelm?
Yeah, so let's say like often what happens is like I do a lot of networking and I meet a lot of people and there's all these catch ups to have and follow ups and things like that. And so what I do is I don't do it straight away. I do it when I like if someone comes and says, "Can you do this or that?" I'll usually say, "Or can you come here?" or I'll just say, let me confirm. So I try and always answer. So I answer so that they're not left hanging. And then I say, let me confirm. And then I will come back and I try and make sure I have a list of all these people that I either have to come back to or that I did want to catch up or that we've sort of verbally said, let's have a catch up and things like that. So that's one sort of simple area where I just don't commit straight away. I just say, let me
That's
confirm.
a great strategy. I like that.
I've trained myself to say, let me confirm.
Moana, how about you? How good are you with setting boundaries?
Probably a lot better since having my grandchildren because I used to just meet up with people just for the sake of meeting up. Now I meet up with people that are close to me or for a business reason. But now I think, it's taking me away from other priorities. So I do set boundaries. And I think when you do have overwhelm, in a way it forces you to set some boundaries because there's no way we can physically split ourselves into two or three people. And it's just physically impossible to do everything that everybody would like you to do. So it really, I think as you get older and you have more in your life, the better you get at setting boundaries.
How important are people to you? Are they one of your priorities? Do you put other things aside for people, or do you then go, no, this is actually more important, that person is okay? How do you balance that?
I do actually go by people and what people want, so I guess I am a bit of a people pleaser in that way. And it all depends on how urgent it is, or someone needs me, or someone wants me to do something. I can be I seem to squeeze in the things that I want to get done as well. But yeah, people are a priority for me rather than, when I was working for the skincare business, they used to drum into you to do income producing activity all the time. I don't sort of think of that probably as much as I should. I'll always put the people first.
You mentioned before that you have strategies to avoid overwhelm. What is a strategy? Talk me through a strategy.
Well, it's quite simple for me. Because I think we've all got the same thing, that we're all trying to do too many things all at once. And with the networking group that I run, we have an accountability group. So every week, every Tuesday, we set ourselves a goal for that week, and we break that goal into three tasks. And we know that once those three tasks have been completed, then that goal is achieved. And I'm the one that keeps the goal sheet and keeps everybody accountable, but I was guilty of putting down too many goals all at once. And that was my big lesson to learn, that I was really being greedy by having all these goals listed. And then because I couldn't achieve any of them, the whole week would go by and I was doing my freezing up thing where I wasn't getting them done. So now I've learned to put a small achievable goal. And I would achieve that goal. And if I had time for the rest of the week, then I would put another goal in. So that was kind of my reward. I love ticking off a list, and that this is what I did. Ticked off that goal, then I could put another one in.
Word in there, greedy. Why do you
Oh,
feel greedy?
well, I don't know if greedy is the right word, but maybe I was being a bit optimistic in that I could achieve all of those goals. But yeah, I thought that I think Mary said something similar. I thought that I could achieve in a week more than I could achieve. So I have learned now to have smaller goals broken down into three smaller tasks, and then just get that one done, and then the next one and the next one.
What does that do for you if you achieve, let's say, one, two, three small tasks in one day? What does
Yeah.
that do for you for
Oh,
the
I
rest of
feel
the
good.
day?
Yeah, I feel good. I feel like I've achieved something, and anything else is the icing on the top of the cake. You know, I really like that book. What's it? Eat That Frog First. So it's doing the things that you don't want to do. Maybe balance the bank statement or something. Things that you don't want to do first, then everything else after that's enjoyable. So that was a really good book for me to read, and lesson for me to hear about years and years ago. So I do think about that. Once you've got that done, it feels good.
Great. I'll have to write that down and we'll put that the name of that book in the chat in the comments.
Yeah.
Mary, how about you? What's a strategy that you use?
Oh, I have quite a few of them. The first one is my mantra of just because you can doesn't mean you should. And because I have this person that I'm really capable, you know, there's so many things that I can do. And so I spend a lot of time going, oh yeah, I can do that. That's not a problem. Easy, easy for me. And then I had to learn that just because I could do it didn't mean I should do it. And that I was actually disempowering other people by, if you will, hogging the work and keeping it all for myself. Because if you don't share the load, then you're not giving other people an opportunity to have a growth experience, to learn something new and to achieve a goal of their own. So
Yeah.
for me, looking at it from that reframe really helps a lot. The other thing that I find really helps is, so Moana talked about having smaller, more achievable goals. We were encouraged to set big, hairy, audacious goals for a long time, and a lot of big coaches and so forth will go, get out there and set the biggest goals you can. And what that does is that leaves you feeling, like Moana said, a bit of a failure because you haven't achieved those goals because they're just too big to fit in. So what I tend to do now is to still have a big, hairy, audacious goal, but to be really kind to myself around the way that I work towards that goal, in that making it smaller, more manageable, chunking it down, smaller, more manageable steps to get there, and then strategizing where those steps fit in the process of, allowing anything up to a year or more to create this thing that I want to create. Because I mean, I help people write books. So clearly, if you want to write a really good book, you're not going to do it in 48 hours. You're not going to do it in 3 weeks. You're not going to do it in 12 weeks. If you want to write a really good book, you have to break it down and take it slowly and do all the various steps that are required to write a book. Now, a lot of people find that super overwhelming, and I certainly did with my first one. I found it terribly overwhelming when I first wrote my book. Now I look at it as, okay, this is a big, hairy, audacious, a book is a big, hairy, audacious goal. Chunk it down, make it into little spots. And so I do that with my clients, and then I had to remind myself to do it with me too. So the big, hairy, audacious goal is still there. I try to do one at a time. Try not to do more than one big, hairy, audacious goal at a time. And then I have my short-term things that I need to get done in a short term. I have my medium-term things that are slightly larger, but not enormous. And I try
Well,
to just
short
have
term.
one big, hairy, audacious, two mediums that I'm working on, and however many short terms is necessary to get to achieve the other thing. So my short-term goals work towards the other longer-term strategies that I'm working on.
Short-term goals. How short is short term?
Well, sometimes it's this morning I'm going to get this finished. This morning I will achieve X. So sometimes it's before 1 hour's time I will achieve X. It's about setting yourself a task and a deadline and a when you're going to get that thing done so you've achieved that goal, which was to finish X in this period of time. Sometimes it's 2 days or 3 days or up to a week. But my short-term goals, I call anything up to a week as a short-term goal.
Moana, you spoke before about crossing off to-do lists. Can a task on a to-do list be too small?
Not really. If it's a step to achieving a goal, it's important to do it. Otherwise, if you don't do it, you don't achieve the goal. So, and we encourage everyone to make that goal. It could be a personal goal, or it could be to do with anything, but we encourage everyone to break it down into tasks so that you can see the progress of that goal. Once you've done the third task, the goal's done.
I've got to say, I'm one to use a big black pen on my to-do list so that I know I've crossed off some tasks. That's a good
Very
feeling.
satisfying.
Angela, strategies.
That is.
Talk me through some strategies that help you deal with overwhelm.
So I think like the other, like Moana was saying about the task list. So when I'm overwhelmed, I will on a regular basis, so at least once a week, I end up creating a big master to-do list where I spend time dumping everything down. So everything that I can think of, because sometimes things slip through the cracks and I haven't written them down. Like there's something just as we're talking, I'm remembering something I haven't done. I said I would do, but I said I would do it as soon as possible. And so I didn't exactly give a deadline. But so, yeah, so I have this master to-do list. And then I, every day, so I either work on the same list for a week. So sometimes I might have the same to-do list for a week. And then I'll prioritize, what I need to do that day. And often, like for example, today, I've got a deadline. I have to deliver a masterclass on Monday evening. And so I'm working backwards. So it's Thursday and it's like a new sort of PowerPoint that I don't have. So it's like, I was hoping to have it done already by today, and it's the afternoon. So it's actually a bigger job than what I was expecting or hoping. But so I either do that, so I'll either work backwards, like I'll look at what I've got coming up over the next few days, so I know I've got time in order to actually get this thing done. So I need some more blank spaces for this. And so I'm not gonna, but I've allocated myself half a day today because then there's another thing I want to get done. So it's
So
kind of
you're not a crammer?
yes and no. So I'm a yes and no. Yes and no. So I think I don't like stress. I don't like too much stress. And so that's why I've learned, and I actually need quite a bit of downtime. Like that's just my personality. So I need, if I've got a calendar that's chockers, that, and I look at that, I'm stressed. It's like this tension. It's like I need some things in there, but not too full. Really interesting. And so my strategies are to keep myself lean on the ground with what I've committed to. And if I know I have to get something, because I'm a coach, obviously, and I have a Calendly link and people can book into my calendar. So I make sure that if I need to block out time, that it's blocked out in my calendar so that no one can book me then, just in case some things pop up, which can often happen. Yeah. And I've trained myself to look in my to-do list, to look in my calendar ahead of time so that I can readjust things without letting people down if I need to.
You meditate a lot.
Yes.
How big a help do you think that is?
Well, because I've been doing it for so long, like this is my 30th year of having a meditation practice, it's like super helpful. And I just find that I would probably be very dysfunctional without it.
Do you solve problems while you're meditating?
Yes, and sometimes. I mean, I'm trying to focus on the object of meditation, you know, which is what meditation is about. But yeah, I do. Like sometimes things, I'll be able to see something from a different perspective, or I'll, yes, so I do solve problems. Because the other day I was, yeah, so I do, without even meaning to, yes.
Mary, how about you? I know I look, put me in the shower and I can just think through everything clearly. Mary, do you have a strategy like that? That,
Mine's the bathtub. Mine's the bathtub. A bathtub is amazing. Get your magnesium salts and your hot water and get in there. And not only does it ease all of that tension in your body, when you were sitting still, or went for me, when I'm sitting still, my brain turns on. When I'm going flat, my brain's just getting from one thing to the next. It's too busy. And it doesn't have that capacity to think things through. But if I find myself really stuck with how do I do this, or in that moment of going, too much, I've gotten really cranky and I've snapped at someone or I've bit my kid's head off or my husband's. That's when I know bathtub time, get in the tub, sit there and take time. And I've learnt now to set an alarm for half an hour, because if I'm jumping out 10 minutes later, it's not long enough. And there are times when I sit there and just kind of start to fade off and go off into another world. And if I haven't set an alarm, I might be there for 2 hours. And that's actually too long, apart from getting out freezing cold and looking like a prune. The obvious, but it is too long, because then you're behind because you've taken too long out. So if I set an alarm for half an hour as I'm getting in, I find that's the optimal time. First 10 minutes is that settling down time. And then after that, that's when the mind turns on. I allow myself to quieten in that first 10 minutes, and then my mind turns on, and suddenly I've just got so many answers to the things that I was going, oh, I don't know how to work this out, or I don't know what am I going to do with that, oh God, I haven't got time to think about that. And when you actually give yourself that space to quieten down and to wind down that little bit, you go, oh, of course, that's so easy, why didn't I think of that before? And it's just magical. I actually did it on Sunday morning. I did it on Sunday morning, and there's things that I've been arguing with myself about for probably 2 months that I got answers to on Sunday morning, just sitting in the bathtub, because there was no pressure. I'd just gone,
Do you
okay, I'm
take
just
a
going to
pen
sit
and a
here.
notepad in there with you?
No, you'd end up with a big soggy mess. No, but what I do do when I get out is I quickly make notes or take a voice recording straight afterwards, because you do forget if you don't. Well, I do. I do forget if I don't keep that record after the tub session. I do find that 2 days later, I'll remember it for about 2 days. I'll be like, oh, this is so good. I'm going to do this and I'm going to do that. And this is going to sort itself out. But if I don't take notes, it's gone. 2 days later, I go, oh, I had a really good idea about that in the tub. What was that? And I'm sitting there going, oh, I can't remember. Then I've got to get in the tub again, which is such a bad thing.
Not bad knowing these things, is it? Moana, how about you? Do you have a place like that? You have water, trees, do you have a place like that?
Yeah, that's one of the benefits of having two little doggies. So they will come and remind me if they want to go for walks. So if I'm working from home, I'll take them for a walk. And just lately, the last few days, I've been walking on the beach with them first thing in the morning. We used to drive them to the doggy beach on a Sunday, but now I'm just taking them to the beach just down the road from me, first thing in the morning, sometimes right on sunrise, and I find that's really nice. In the summertime, I will go and have a swim in the ocean. That's my place to just feel refreshed, and also doing something creative really is good as well. I've even bought some of those paint by numbers. They're really good to do. Just the cheap ones from Coles, or I've picked them up from the post office, and I'll just do the paint by numbers, and it just sort of takes you out of yourself. I guess it is a form of meditation. Active meditation. I do
Do
Pilates
you find that
as
you
well.
have ideas while you're doing that?
No, not really. It stops me from thinking too much about anything. I do have ideas in the middle of the night. I come up some, if I wake up, I'll have an idea. I had a few ideas from my website. On my
Do you have
website,
pen
I
and
thought all
paper?
about. No, I just remembered it. I just rem In the morning, I just like Mary was saying when she gets out of the bath. My description that I put on my website about my name and meaning ocean and oceans of possibilities and things like that, they just made me feel really good. And I contacted Sumi then, who was doing, she did my website, and I said, I want this put on my website. So it's still on there now. And I had that thought that came up in the middle of the night. And I just think being creative really helps with the overwhelm.
It's really a matter of knowing what works for you, isn't it? Because if I wake during the night with an idea and I don't write it down, it's gone in the morning and I can spend days going, oh, I know I had this great idea, but what was it? No idea. And maybe sometimes it comes back without me even really connecting it, but oh, it's a matter of knowing what works for you.
And that's why it's so good to collaborate and get different ideas from different people. It gets the energy going and stimulates different ideas. It's good.
Well, let's talk about collaboration then. Let's talk about collaboration and people and how important are people when it comes to avoiding overwhelm? Moana, you do a lot of networking. You have a community of people around you. How important are they for you to either avoid overwhelm or work through overwhelm, or are they there as a distraction?
Oh, they, a lot of my networking is unofficial networking. It's networking with friends. I actually caught up with some friends just before, and we were helping another friend to sort. It's brainstorming. I think it's so valuable to get together, and I think women are especially good at doing this, just brainstorming, and just we come up with the gold.
Is it conscious brainstorming or do you just talk and you just come up with things?
Well, it's conscious in that we all want to help each other, and we're all trying to sort out, give each other ideas, and we all have a different perspective on different ways of doing things. Or if someone is, well, today, it's someone not putting her health first and putting other things first. So we were all helping her out with that, and we actually took her into the doctor's surgery and got an appointment made. And it's just really, I just think it's so powerful to have that energy. And it doesn't always need to be the structured networking. It's, I have so many instances of talking to someone and they know someone else who knows someone else. And yeah, I can't think of it at the moment, but I've had that this week, a couple of people knowing different things. Oh, that's right. It was an exercise physiologist. Yeah, about, because I've actually got osteoporosis. So it was a referral to go and see about doing this weight bearing exercise.
Yeah, community is incredibly important. Angela, you have created a community through She Simply Impacts. Tell me the value of an organizer or a community like She Simply Impacts when it comes to overwhelm.
Look, it's so valuable because it's like talking things through. Because when we're overwhelmed, one of the problems is that we're in our own head. Like we don't know, we can't see the forest for the trees. And there's just, or we can, but we've overcommitted. And so we've just got to follow through and just deal with the consequences of it. So having someone to actually, because to help just talk it through, like Moana's saying, is just so invaluable. And just to hear someone reflect back, like, I mean, you happened to call me yesterday out of the blue, and it was just so valuable what you said to me. You just said, focus on my masterclasses. And it was like, yeah, it's like I've thought of that before. And but then all these other things come in the way. And so it's like, so it's just incredible. That's what She Simply Impacts is. And the attendees that come to the sessions, like one came recently and she just wanted to celebrate. She just wants to check in. Is she doing okay? This is what she's thinking. These are her priorities and this is how she's, and it's just getting that reflected back. But yes, that's great. We're doing this to build relationships. We're having these discussions so that we get to catch up and we get to build relationships and people get to build relationships with us. So to me, community is everything. Like it really, really is. Like I'm just so grateful for each and every one of you and all the experts in She Simply Impacts and all the attendees, because I learned so much, and all my clients, because I learned so much from them.
Absolutely. Mary, how do you use your community when it comes to overwhelm? Do you just go and hang out with them? Or you go, I've got a problem that I've got to get through, and so there's someone in particular that you will call? Or what is it that you do? Or do you just withdraw? How do you use community?
It's a really great question, actually. I've been listening to you all talk about how wonderful it is to have community and thinking to myself, sometimes it's too much community that overwhelms me. Sometimes I actually need to withdraw for a little bit and just take my own advice. And as I was thinking about that while you were talking, and I realized what the difference was, and I thought, it's really about discerning who it is that you listen to within your community and making sure that the people you surround yourself with in that community are the people who are going to give you good advice, who aren't out just to look after themselves, who are prepared to do the give and take, receive from you, but also to give back to you and keep that balance going. So for me in my community, I have to be very aware of who it is that I'm reaching out to when I've got a problem. And slowly but surely, I was thinking about this just yesterday. Slowly but surely, I'm building a team of people, a tribe, that word tribe. I almost don't want to use it, but it is kind of tribal. It's that group of people with very similar values, with very similar, expectations about what life should be about and the way that we talk to each other and the way that we help each other. And when you have those sorts of people around you, you can reach out, whether it's because you've got a friend who's got a lime tree and you need a lime halfway through cooking dinner, or whether it's because you've got a cybersecurity issue and you've got an amazing cybersecurity expert that you can reach out to, or whether it's even within the business realm, within coaching and things like that, to have a coach or a counselor who you can rely on to give you the best outcome possible by listening to you and listening to your needs and asking the right questions and being in that space rather than going, well, this is how I do it, therefore that's how it's done, which is not what coaching or counseling is. But they're listening to you and they're asking the right questions and they're approaching you with non-judgment, with pure acceptance, and with curiosity around what else is possible so that you are coming up with your own answers, but they're facilitating those answers. That's what a really good coach or a really good counselor is. They're not telling you to live their life. They're helping you to live your life. And that's what's really special about She Simply Impacts, because that's the sorts of people that we have in She Simply Impacts. And it's really, really special. And I love that I'm getting more of those sorts of people around me. That I know that Ange and I had a chat last week, and we're just talking over stuff. And that moment of asking a certain question is that moment where you just go, oh, of course. I knew that. And it is that matter of bringing it from the subconscious into the conscious and going, I knew that. I knew that all along. I just couldn't find it by myself. And that's where that's really special to have that community. That's how I tend to draw on community around me, is to make sure I've got the right people around me first, and then to spend time in discussion with them where the answers just come up.
Do you think?
And I amaze myself sometimes when I'm talking. I have to say this. We have a conversation with someone, and there'll be something that I'm just not sure about, and suddenly they'll say something, and I go, oh, well, da 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 da, and then I go, oh, wow, that was really wise from, and it was actually in me. Was with me all along, but I didn't actually realize it was there until I was having that conversation.
Well,
So
sometimes you just have to
that's, and we
hear.
all have that.
Sometimes you just have to hear something at a particular time, and it's that time to sink in, doesn't it? Mary, do you think it has something to do with it, to find something to do with find the time where you found your right community? I mean, you were talking about, if you've got a community of similar values. Do you think age has something to do with that?
I think values are something that you carry with you through life, and yes, they do refine as you grow older, as you have more experiences, as your life experiences change you, because sometimes something that's not so important to you at one phase in life is more important to you in another. But your deep-seated values, like things like service, community, honesty, integrity, things like that, they kind of stay with you as you go through. So the really big values, the really deep-seated values, I don't think stages of life change those values. I think what you learn as you get older is to discern who those people are that you keep around you and whether or not you're going to listen to the advice that you're given. I mean, once upon a time, I used to listen to every bit of advice anyone gave me and not listen to myself at all and not think about whether it fitted me and my life. And Joe, oh, that person must know better than me. They're giving really good advice. And they seem like they're pretty successful in their life. Therefore, I'm doing it all wrong. And that's not necessarily correct. Sometimes they are right. Sometimes you are doing it wrong. But most times they're giving you advice from their own reference, their own frame of reference. And if they're asking you questions and letting you come to what's going to work for you, that's different. That's very different. So I think that sort of wisdom comes as you get older. Yes, the wisdom gets stronger as you age and as you experience more things. But I think your values, the deep-seated values, are always there. It's just learning to find those people.
There's a lot of good things that come with age, isn't there?
Oh, absolutely. I love the hair color.
Angela, mental health. So can overwhelm lead to mental health problems or deeper mental health problems, do you think? Where do we need to be careful? How do we need to be careful? What are the connections there?
Yeah, I think we do need to be careful of certain, we've already touched on the themes, which is like people pleasing and not being able to say no. And, what Mary just shared now, which was listening to other people rather than, being true to ourselves and actually stopping to do that self-discovery piece and feeling confident and backing ourselves. So I think that, yeah, I mean, if like being in a state of constant overwhelm, I mean, that's incredibly stressful. That's like really pushing your nervous system right to the limit. And that is dangerous, like not having routines or habits in place, like, yes, I meditate, but I also exercise on a regular basis. And that really helps me so much. And so, and I know that last year when I was doing that job with the government, the Self-Employment Assistance Program as the business mentor, I just got really overwhelmed. Well, it was practically on the verge of burnout. And after I quit that job, because I was doing She Simply Impact plus my own personal branding coaching, plus working 4 days a week and coaching, all the participants in the program and driving around and things like that, but it was just way too much. And I took 6 weeks off after that. So I got, I mean, I, yes, I had a lot on my plate, but it was too much. Like I was saying before, my schedule was too full and there was not enough downtime. And I was working all on the weekends. I mean, I still work a lot on the weekends, but now my schedule's a lot more flexible. So I can take downtime at different times of the day if I need to. So yeah, I think it does. I think that constant overwhelm is dangerous. That's why we're having this.
You just touched on something, Angela, that is probably very common in the community where people have a job. They work for other people. They realize they've got way too much on their plate, or there's way too much pressure on them. And that might be from their employment, that might be from employment and life, might be a whole heap of things. But how do you, as an employee, manage that? Because you can't just walk away. You can't just go on 6 weeks leave unless you have 6 weeks leave or unless you have take stress leave. How do you manage those sort of situations? You
Yeah.
know, is it through communication with whoever, you know, you need to have that communication with? Like, what is it? What are some of the things that you can do?
I think what I've seen through, the three jobs I had, like over since COVID, since 2020, I think that people just it just leads to burnout. Like if you, I think, yeah, you need to like people can go on stress leave. People can, well, I mean, when you're an employee, you can take leave, and paid leave. So there are options to take paid leave. And, I mean, that's one of the blessings of being an employee. But I've seen people in those jobs that I was in where, like, even a client of mine that I've just started working with, she's a social worker and she's worked in community services and in all kinds of different roles through social work and being on the front line. And she, experienced, she got to the point where she was really burnt out. Like she just couldn't do it anymore. It really impacted everything, her mental health. She had to take time. It is. I just don't think it's sustainable and I don't know how people do it. I mean, I've always mainly been self-employed. And, I could quit that job because I know that I've got services, I've got a business, and I didn't stop running the business even when I was working. So I had a personal brand and a business, and that's why I love personal branding. And I think that everyone needs to have their own identity and not have, like, having one thing only, I think, is also a dangerous strategy.
That's great advice. That's great advice. Mary, I know that you have worked with people on how to have difficult conversations. Is there anything that you want to add to that? You
Oh,
know,
there's
how
so
do you
many.
have a difficult conversation
Yeah,
with
there's
an
so many.
employer, with an
There's so
employee,
many
employer?
aspects, yeah, around that with regards to difficult conversations. The model that I use a lot for difficult conversations is a three-step model where you start off with just the facts, not what you're thinking may mean, but what the actual facts are. Like you walked in, you said this. That's the fact. And then your story around the facts that it made me feel or think this, and then an open question. So can you help me reconcile this with this and help me understand what's going on here? So that's the open question, rather than I think you're angry, am I right? Which is the closed question. So that's a very simple, it's called crucial conversations model. That's a very simple explanation of that model, but it is a very powerful model. It really helps you to have those conversations. So when you are feeling overwhelmed at work and you feel like the boss is giving you too much, has too high expectation of you, the opportunity to talk about that then would be, yesterday you told me you need X, Y, and Z done by 3 p.m. today, but I'm also working on this project, and this project, which all have deadlines by 4 p.m. today. It's left me feeling really like I'm unsupported and like there's way too many expectations. I'm wondering if you've thought about other ways that I could, or if you have suggestions around other ways that I could manage this, my thoughts are I could do dot dot dot, like can I put this off, or I could put that off. I'm wondering if that sounds like reasonable approach to you, or if you have any other ideas about how I could manage that, which would be that difficult conversation to say to the boss, hey, you forgot that you've given me this on top of that and that and that. And that's just way too much to expect of any koala bear. So, think about what you're giving me. And if the boss then comes back and says, no, anyone reasonable in your job should be able to manage that, then you're going to use that formula again. And you just keep using that formula until you get to a point where you have an outcome. Sometimes it's also a matter of doing things for yourself that are going to help you with the hormones in that position as well. It's not just the conversation. There's this group of happy, what we call the happy hormones, is the dopamine, the oxytocin, the serotonin, and the endorphins. So the dopamine is the one that like gives you motivation. So it's a happy hormone. Oxytocin is the love and trust hormone. Serotonin gives you that sort of confidence and self-acceptance, and the endorphins give you that sort of sense of euphoria. So they all come from different areas, and if you can work on those four hormones, they actually give you an ability to, once you, as you get those levels up, that gives you an ability to not go into burnout anywhere near as easily. I mean, clearly, if we're feeling overwhelmed, there's a reason we got there. And if we're able to make sure our hormones are kept high, endorphins, for example, come from exercise. You go for a walk and you feel great after a walk, it's because you've lifted your endorphins. Your serotonin, they're the happy thoughts. That's the positive thinking, those sorts of things to keep your serotonin up. Oxytocin is about building relationships and feeling like you're in a space of a loving, safe environment, and your dopamine comes from. So dopamine's really cool. Dopamine you can actually improve by taking your glasses off and going outside for 5 minutes and letting unfiltered sunlight hit the back of your eyes. Now, that doesn't mean look at the sun. It just means allow it to hit the back of your eyes, let that unfiltered light hit the back of your eyes. And it's a very cool thing just by doing that for 5 minutes a day that actually raises your dopamine and makes you feel more motivated, like you have that sort of pleasure factor. Things like that help to lower your stress in the other areas. So particularly oxytocin, because cortisol being the stress hormone, the distrust hormone, and oxytocin, they co-regulate. So if your oxytocin's up, your cortisol's down, which is a very cool thing to know, because cortisol's so bad for us. I mean, we need a certain amount, it keeps us moving, but too much cortisol sends us into overwhelm, sends us into stress, sends us into we can get health issues like cancer. It actually is proven linked between high cortisol and cancer. So there's a whole lot of the physical, the emotional, the mental well-being is all tied up together. It's not just this is a mental health thing, it's also a physical health thing. So we need to be aware of all those things and work on all of those things together, have those conversations, because when we don't have those conversations, the love and trust, the oxytocin goes down and the cortisol goes up. So take time to have those conversations. But it's a really cool mishmash of things that work together. And all of those things, as you work on those and raise those, you actually build your resilience and you don't fall over as easily when you are consciously working on keeping those hormones up higher. It makes a huge difference in your life. It's phenomenal. I mean, I have had my own personal experience of building all of those things and how much difference it made for me. I know how much difference it can make for someone just to raise those hormones. It's
There's a
really
lot of gold
phenomenal.
in that, Mary. There's an absolute lot of gold. I mean, you started off with the conversation, the facts about a situation, how I'm feeling, and the question that follows that, and that's led onto the hormones. Does anyone have the feeling that perhaps Mary's quite passionate about this topic?
No, just a little.
Oh, Mary, that was great. Moana, mindset shifts. How do we know when it's time? If we've gone into overwhelm, if we're in not such a great space, how do we know it's time? How can we recognize it's time for a mindset shift so this doesn't happen again? You know, sometimes it's more than just recognizing the overwhelm. It's actually a mindset shift.
Yeah, I think when, because it sometimes a lot of the overwhelm we actually create for ourselves because we keep on piling, you know, especially if you are a creative person, you keep on piling more and more things on your to-do list or your goal list, and you want to achieve these things. And then sometimes you might find that even if you don't have as many things to do, even if you've only got a few things to do, you still feel the same. Has anyone felt like that? I don't know if anyone's read Dr. Libby's the Running Woman Syndrome. If she's only got like two things to do, when normally she might have 12 or 14 things to do in a day, she doesn't feel any different when she has the two things to do to what she does if she has the 14 things to do. And that is a strong sign that you've got used to that feeling of overwhelm, and that's when it's taking its toll, because the sympathetic and the parasympathetic nervous system are out of balance, sort of similar to what Mary was saying. And the idea is to have that balance. So when you've got too much stress, or if you've got the parasympathetic nervous system, you know, that's when it can lead to depression and loss of feeling or emotion about lots and lots of different things, or too much stress. So it's all about balance and making sure that you are fitting the right amount of things into your life that suit you personally. And I think that's a big sign if you feel the same way constantly, no matter how many things you've got on your plate. And then you've got to think, well, this is me. This isn't what is on my plate, on my list of things to do. This is to do with me and my mindset. So I better take some steps to address it.
Very wise words. Listen, guys, it's an hour. Is there anything that anyone would like to add? A final thought? A final strategy? Mary, you got your hand up?
Yeah, and I think the biggest thing about overwhelm for anyone is to recognize that we're all human and we all make mistakes, and it's okay to get in a space that other people go, oh, that's not a good space to be in, rather than to take on the judgment that comes in that, well, you know, you're not in a good place. Take it on as a someone's recognizing what I'm already feeling within myself. It's okay to reach out. It's okay to say, you know what, you're right, and I'm recognizing that, and I'm really trying to fix this. Do you have any suggestions? Or allow yourself to not feel judged, but more importantly, to not judge yourself, because we are our own worst critics. We're so hard on ourselves, and we look at ourselves and go, oh God, I got that wrong. I'm so bad. I'm that, you know, and we judge ourselves so badly. Rather than, oh God, I got that wrong. I'm human. Fancy. I got it wrong. So that's okay. I'm human. I got it wrong. I can learn from this and then move on. And look after yourself in the whole process. Be kind to yourself, because we all get it wrong. Doesn't matter how far along we are, you still get it wrong.
We do. We wouldn't be developing really as people if we didn't get things wrong and learn from those mistakes, would we? Angela Moana, is there anything that you would like to add as a final comment? Any other strategies that you'd like to talk about or pass on?
Oh, just I think overwhelm, a great big sigh is sometimes really good. I remember when my children were little, they used to say, "Oh, you sigh a lot, Mum." But I realise now, after learning, you know, about breathing, and if you're wanting to hype yourself up, you need to do those short, sharp breaths. And then if you're overwhelmed with everything, just that big sigh is really good, just to let it all out, and also to share and talk with other women. And like we've said before, She Simply Impacts is perfect for that, because you've just got all these experts that can help you out when you are feeling overwhelmed.
Absolutely. All right. Angela, are you good?
I'm great. I think that this has been a golden conversation. I think it's been so valuable, and I've learned a lot. So.
Great. Well, look, there is so much that has come out of this. I've got a whole list of notes here. I've got things like, Angela, you said at the beginning the words Let me confirm. I love that. I love that. I thought that was great. Moana, you talked about accountability in a group. And that's fantastic as well. You're doing things in a group. You're out there with that community that you just talked about. Mary, you said just because you can doesn't mean you should. And that's a brilliant quote as well. We were talking about reframing. We were talking about blocking out calendars. We were talking about the shower and the bath and meditation for calming down and letting the ideas flow. Exercise routines. Mary, you said before, I'm human. I am only human. Stop judging myself. And Moana, you've just talked about the big sigh. Look, there has just been so much that's come out of this conversation. I want to thank you, ladies, for being here, for sharing your knowledge, and for sharing with us your experiences. I've learned a lot, and I'm sure everyone else will as well. So thank you very much.
Wonderful. Bye, everyone. Thank you so much. Thanks. Thank you.